Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. Before I move to question number one, I'd indicated that I would respond to Douglas Ross's point in relation to points he made about the public gallery being cleared for a time during proceedings on Tuesday evening. I've looked into the matter and understand that the Chamber was suspended when the points were made. As a consequence, the Chamber system was not live while the member was making his point. Consequently, there is no recording of his comments and we're unable to replicate them in the official report. However, the member's subsequent points of order are, of course, a matter of record, as will be my response. Members will be aware that the public gallery was reopened following the resumption of business. I would also like to comment, as I'd indicated, that I'd respond to Alexander Burnett's point in relation to the distribution of votes results. I have looked into the matter and can advise members that vote results during Stage 3 were circulated in accordance with long-standing practice, including being made available to the media during proceedings. But I have listened to the point made by Mr Burnett and will review this practice for future Stage 3 proceedings, and we will discuss this with business managers. I now move to general questions, and at question number one, I call Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it is doing to improve and maintain the road network in Scotland.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
The Scottish Government continues to invest in the motorway and trunk road network. Our future investment priorities are set out in the recently published Second Strategic Transport Projects Review and focus on improving safety, climate change adaptation and resilience on the road network. Scotland's 32 local authorities are responsible for the operation and maintenance of their respective local road networks.
Rhoda Grant.
I thank the Minister for that response, and as she said, local authorities are responsible for their road network, but it was recently reported that Highland Council may slash their road maintenance budget by more than half, from £20 million to £9 million next year. If that goes ahead, the amount is completely inadequate, especially as Highland Council manages the largest road network in Scotland. These roads are considered some of the worst in Scotland, so will the Scottish Government intervene and ensure that roads, which are a lifeline in remote areas, are adequately maintained in Highland Council area?
Minister.
As the member will be aware, I cannot, as a Scottish Minister, intervene in relation to local roads. Local authorities have a duty under the Roads Scotland Act 1984. They have to maintain local roads in their area, and their duties are specified under the Road Traffic Regulation Act of 1984 to secure the expeditious, convenient and safe movement of traffic. So neither Scottish Ministers nor the Scottish Government could become directly involved in the day-to-day duties in that respect. The vast majority of funding that does flow to local authorities from Scottish Government, as I alluded to in my initial response to Ms Grant, is via the block grant, and we do not stipulate how local authorities should utilise their local allocation. So it is therefore the responsibility of each local authority, including Highland Council, to manage their own budget and to allocate the financial resources that are available to them on the basis of local needs and priorities, having first, of course, fully fulfilled their statutory obligations and the jointly agreed to set out national and local priorities.
Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It was recently announced that the Scottish Government intends to invest approximately £5 million in additional road safety measures for the A9 between now and 2025. Can I ask the Minister what the Government anticipates it will achieve through this welcome investment?
Minister.
I thank the member for her question. There have been a number of fatalities on the A9 recently, and every one of those deaths, and any on Scotland roads, is one too many. Having spoken with Police Scotland on a number of occasions and with officials about safety performance on the road in recent months, I know there's a wide range of underlying reasons for the accidents that have occurred, and that it will need a combination of engineering, education and enforcement to influence driver behaviour going forward. In light of the recent poor safety performance on the A9, I commissioned Transport Scotland to develop a series of short-term measures that could be used to improve safety on the A9 in advance of duelling. Those total £5 million and were announced last week. The recently announced road safety investment is made up of a series of targeted improvements that include lining, signing and key junctions on the A9. That looks at improving driver information as well for single carriageways and road safety awareness campaigns, initially on fatigue and drive on the left awareness. I'm also undertaking some work with car hire companies, particularly in relation to foreign drivers who may not be familiar with the road itself. But those measures are expected to help address the causes, of course, of the tragic accidents we've seen on the A9 this year.
Thank you. I will require more succinct responses, Minister. I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. Will the Minister not just accept that it is underfunding of Scotland's councils that is leading to the deteriorating road network?
Minister.
I don't accept Mr Simpson's assertion in that respect. We've had interventions today, or questions rather today, from a member in relation to local roads. Local roads are the responsibility of local authorities, and I would invite the member to critique his own party's record in recent months in relation to financial responsibility, because the recklessness of Mr Simpson's party has caused serious concern to this government and our ability to provide a reliable and an informed service to our local authority partners, who of course have responsibility for local roads.
Question number two, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what consideration it's given to supporting the gaming industry in Scotland during the cost of living crisis.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While the current climate is extremely difficult for all businesses, the Scottish Government is actively working to support the gaming sector in Scotland. We want to build on the recent success of Scottish Games Week by working with the sector to leverage the best support from the opportunities and assets that are available, such as our national TechScaler Network, a £42 million investment which will widen access to entrepreneurial opportunities and support founders, including the gaming industry.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for his response. He'll be aware that since 2014 and up to the most recent survey data for 2021, global surveys suggest the number of women employed each year in gaming industries is low, and indeed with a peak of only 30% for 2021. Given the importance of both the sector and women to our economy, will the Minister consider reviewing and then monitoring on a regular basis the gender divide in the gaming sector in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Michelle Thompson is raising an extremely important aspect to the success of the gaming sector and reflects on its room to grow, with a growing part of that sector coming from the female workforce, which I think we are all in favour of. Scottish Government, I think it's fair to say, everyone with an interest in building up and boosting Scotland's game sector is keenly aware of the existing gender imbalance, while noting that across the digital economy more widely, this imbalance is sadly not unique to gaming. A recent paper, Scotland's Games Ecosystem, The State of Play, Challenges and Opportunities, written by academics from the Universities of Glasgow and Stirling in collaboration with the Scottish Games Network and InGame, makes similar points in calling for the collection and publication of metrics that will evidence progress towards an open, inclusive game sector in Scotland. I commit to Michelle Thompson that this is something I'll be paying close attention to.
Question number three, Graeme Day.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will seek to achieve a balance between food and energy security in relation to permitting the use of productive agricultural land for the deployment of large-scale solar arrays.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Presiding Officer, land and the natural capital it supports is one of our most valuable assets, and it is critical to our ambitions for Scotland to be a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. Recent years have seen a series of global shocks, most recently the illegal invasion of Ukraine, which is having an undeniable impact on global food security and upon all aspects of our domestic food and drink supply chain. A recent vision for Scottish agriculture sets out our intention for the new agriculture bill to be adaptive in supporting farmers, crofters and land managers in the near, medium and long-term future to reflect this, whilst recognising the wider need for bold actions to tackle the climate emergency. Given that Scotland has some of the most extensive renewable generation capabilities in Europe, the revised draft National Planning Framework 4, if approved by Parliament, will limit most types of development on prime agricultural land. However, it does allow for renewable energy developments, such as solar, on prime agricultural land, providing the layout and design of proposals minimises the amount of such land required.
Graeme Day.
I thank the Minister for that answer. My Angus South constituency is the subject of multiple planning applications for solar arrays, specifically in the area of the Siddles. Now, I recognise the Minister perhaps cannot comment on applications in particular localities, but can I ask if he could offer me some reassurance that the issue of cumulative impact is something that can and will be taken account of in circumstances such as these?
Minister.
I can thank Graham Day for his supplementary, as I know he will fully appreciate it. As the decision maker for each proposal, who will be required to consider the planning merits of each case, taking full account of all the information submitted by parties involved, including members of the local community. Current Scottish planning policy sets out that whilst considerations will vary relative to the scale of the proposal and area characteristics, these are likely to include cumulative impacts. In due course, however, our National Planning Framework 4 will replace SPP and become part of the Statutory Development Plan, meaning its policies will inform day-to-day planning decision-making. A revised NPF 4 sets out that potential impacts on communities, nature and other receptors remain important considerations in the decision-making process.
With briefly, Minister.
With the revised draft NPF 4 Energy Policy 11, including the need for consideration of cumulative impacts, which I hope provides some reassurance from the member.
Question number 4, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken to close the autism spectrum employment gap.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
There are no official statistics available on autism spectrum employment gaps. But Scottish Government policies and approaches supported by our key stakeholders, including disabled people's organisations, are person-centred and focused on what a person can and wants to do and what they may be, need support with, irrespective of what their impairment may be. And the Scottish Government's focus is placed on reducing the overall disability employment gap, in line with our commitment to at least half the gap, 18.7 percentage points by 2038, compared with 2016. And our latest figures show that in the last 5 years, the disability employment gap has reduced by 6.2 percentage points to 31.2, which means we're showing progress.
Colin Smith.
I thank the Minister for that answer. At a time businesses are facing real labour shortages, one of the most important actions we can take to close that employment gap is to raise understanding of autism among the non-autistic population, in particular many businesses. Now, I'm sure the Minister is aware of the Usual Place project in Dumfries and their outstanding autism awareness project, which is funded through the government's increasing understanding of autism programme. Can I ask the Minister if he'll give an assurance that this increasing understanding of autism programme is not being axed by the government, and that projects like this will continue to get support so local businesses can benefit from the talents of the amazing young people who this project supports?
Minister.
I agree with the sentiments of the member's points, and of course projects like this one he cites, which are excellent projects, are making a huge contribution to this issue. And there's a number of measures the government are taking to support breaking down barriers with employers across the country through funding through our Workplace Equality Fund and other sources as well. So we want to continue to support as many projects as we can within the financial constraints we face, because many of the projects, such as the one mentioned, are doing a very valuable job.
Question number 5, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what engagement it has with the UK Government regarding reports of delays of payment of energy bills support scheme vouchers.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
The Scottish Government is fully aware of the challenges consumers with prepayment meters are having in accessing the energy bills support scheme vouchers. This is why we are continuing to call upon the UK Government to ensure that the correct measures are in place to guarantee that everyone in Scotland is receiving the support they are entitled to. I would urge anybody struggling to access their support scheme vouchers to contact Advice Direct Scotland, who will be able to help in the first instance.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Minister for his response. I'm receiving correspondence from constituents who are Scottish Power customers, and also correspondence from Park Home residents about the delays in receiving energy bill relief. Can I ask the Minister what support is available to my constituents affected by these delays?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, the member may be aware that on Monday the UK Government announced that the £400 Energy Bills Support Scheme alternative funding will be distributed early next year to all consumers without a direct relationship with energy suppliers, including those who are Park Home residents. And I hope that this will help in what has been an unprecedented level of delay experienced by constituents like Mr. Beattie's. The member will also be aware that just last week in the budget we also announced a continuation of our uprated £20 million in the Fuel Insecurity Fund to ensure that there is support for those in the greatest need right through 2023-2024.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the delay in issuing the vouchers, what can the Minister say about local reports that customers eligible for off-grid oil and alternative fuel support will have to sign up to an online portal for the fuel payment on top of the unacceptable delay? Considering the large numbers of off-grid customers in Scotland, including in Shetland, can the Minister indicate any discussions he's had with the UK Government, including offers to assist in helping distribute the funds?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we've made continued representation to the UK Government on these matters because of the bureaucracy that some households are experiencing with the existing scheme. UK ministers have given us assurance that they are pressing energy providers to make sure that they try to speed up the payment of these vouchers as quickly as possible. However, the existing system is still not working in the way in which it should for many consumers, particularly in the member's constituency who have off-grid heating systems. And I can assure the member we'll continue to press the UK Government to make sure that this system operates in a much fairer and much more consistent way right across the country.
Question number six, Graeme Simpson.
And how it ensures good governance in Scotland's colleges.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Scottish Government works with the Scottish Funding Council, Colleges Scotland and College Boards to ensure good governance. We also engage with regional strategic boards, trade unions, student associations and the Colleges Development Network through the Good Governance Steering Group to ensure the implementation of governance improvements.
Graeme Simpson.
I can thank the Minister for that answer. The Minister will be aware of the situation at South Lanarkshire College, where the highly respected principal, who had been looking into serious allegations of theft and malfeasance, has been suspended on full pay for 13 months. That is not due process in anyone's book. The College Board has still not taken a decision, and the costs of this are just going to rise. So does the Minister agree with the comments from the College Principals Group in a letter to the Education Secretary that this raises fundamental issues about good governance and the process relating to how college principals are treated in such circumstances?
Minister.
Let me first of all recognise that Mr Simpson has been pursuing this issue, as is right, given it's a constituency issue for him. Of course, the government is aware in broad terms of some of the detail of the situation at South Lanarkshire College. I should say and be very clear, given that the regional board in the Lanarkshire region is also the board of my local college, I have recused myself from direct involvement in this matter, so I'm not as close to all of the specific details, quite rightly, because it could constitute a conflict of constituency and ministerial interest. But what I can say is our paramount interest at all times is in safeguarding the quality of learning at every college, and that includes South Lanarkshire College. The Scottish Funding Council is a body for with the responsibility of investigating governance issues. It will monitor the situation, will provide updates to the Scottish Government. I know that Mr Simpson has a meeting with the Cabinet Secretary next month to discuss these matters, and you'll have the opportunity to speak to her then.
Thank you. Question number seven, Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
To ask the Scottish Government how many vessels operated by CalMac, Northlink or Scotland's local authorities will be operating past their working life expectancy by the end of the current parliamentary session.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
All vessels within the Clyde and Hebrides and Northern Isles fleets undergo regular maintenance and meet all regulatory requirements. I'm sure Mr Halcrow-Johnston welcomes the procurement this year of two new Islay vessels, the more recent procurement of two further such vessels, plus the MV Glen Sannox and Vessel 802 means that six new major vessels will be delivered between 2023 and 2026, with plans to begin replacing small ferries from 2025. We will shortly issue our draft long-term plan for vessels and ports for consultation next year. Council ferry replacement is, of course, a matter for those local authorities.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
Thank the Minister for that answer. I'd actually welcome the delivery of vessels before necessarily the procurement. It's been estimated by the local council that the cost to replace the ageing inter-island ferries fleet and upgrade infrastructure is around £443 million for Orkney alone. And while it's welcome the government is now finally discussing this with the island's council, I hope talks will lead to more than just talk. However, there are also vital ferry services operated by Shetland, Highland and Argyll and Bute Council in my region alone. So given the importance of these lifeline routes to the communities they serve and the painful lessons being learnt on the west coast of the devastating impact ageing and increasingly unreliable ferries have on local people and local businesses, can the Minister tell me what discussions the Scottish Government is having with these councils on what investment is needed in their fleets and infrastructure and how that investment will be supported by the Scottish Government?
Minister.
I do recognise the challenge for local authorities that have, of course, responsibility for their ferries. The Scottish Government, is worth saying, has provided more than £136 million over the last 5 years alone to support the running of those services. So funding distribution of the Support for Inter-Island Ferry specific grant for 23-24 will be confirmed, of course, in due course. I'm very aware of the growing need for local authorities to replace their ageing ferry fleets and infrastructure, and while responsibility for funding that replacement infrastructure does remain wholly with councils at this current time, I am committed to continuing engagement with Transport Scotland and local authorities. I understand, of course, as the member alluded to, Mr Swinney has been engaging with Orkney Islands Council on that, and I would continue my own engagement as Transport Minister with those local authorities in relation to our role. But I do put on record that local authority ferry services at the current time are the responsibility of local authorities. But we will see what more we may be able to do within the current financial constraints, of course, put in front of this government.